the hell to say today. And I'm talking about the New York Giants. New York Jets are a different story. Because Le'Veon Bell is a member of Gang Green. At least he will be officially, is expected to be officially as of 4 p.m. this afternoon. The New York Giants, however, have decided to trade Odell Beckham Jr. to the Cleveland Browns for a first-round pick, a third-round pick, and safety Jabril Peppers out of Michigan, entering his third year, which, by the way, Peppers can play. He's not Landon Collins, but he is younger, cheaper, chances are potentially a greater upside, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But I got to admit to you, I'm taken aback by the New York Giants' decision to trade Odell Beckham Jr. First of all, I expected him to get more. And secondly, I don't like the fact that he's gone, but Eli's still here. I don't like the fact that Odell Beckham Jr. is gone, but Pat Sherman's still here. I don't like the fact that Odell Beckham Jr. is gone, but Dave Gettleman is still here. But I'll get into all of that a little bit later because I wanted to bring on my next guest, and I'm being told that he's with me right now. He is a host on 98.7 FM, ESPN New York, 10 to 1 p.m. every weekday. He does football analysis for FS1. He is not good. He's great. He's outstanding. And damn it, we should monopolize this man. I'm talking about the great CHRIS CANTY, former Super Bowl champion with the New York Giants, right here with yours truly. What's going on, man? How are you?
Man, I can't call it, Stephen A. Still trying to figure out exactly what the Giants are doing, but a busy day in New York sports, no doubt, with the Giants trading Odell and then, of course, the Jets landing Le'Veon Bell.
Well, let me tell you something right now. I'm the one that needs to be confused, not you. You know your damn football, okay? I don't need you confused. I need you to break this down for me because I got to admit to you, CHRIS, I'm at a loss here. When you decide to let go of Odell Beckham Jr., first things first, why do you think this happened? Why do you think Gettleman made this move?
Well, it's a couple of different things, Stephen A. First of all, I think that this is ownership allowing Dave Gettleman and Pat Shurmur to move on from Beckham. I think it was clear that Beckham wasn't a Pat Shurmur guy. We saw earlier in the season last year he did the sit-down interview with Josina Anderson, and it was kind of weird because he had Lil Wayne there too.
Yep.
But then you heard the criticism that Odell had of Pat Shurmur and the play calling in the second half of that Philadelphia Eagles game down in the link. That's probably not a good look for your first-year head coach. And then, of course, the optics behind Odell Beckham Jr. not diving on that ball on the onside kick in the Chicago Bears game at the end of regulation. Those are all things that you would think that Pat Shurmur would be frustrated with. And so the fact that the Giants are eating as much dead money that as they're eating in 2019, $16.5 million they're eating in dead money, when they trade Odell Beckham Jr., I think that just signals that ownership is on board with the direction that Pat Shurmur and Dave Gettleman are going down. And I think this signals that the Giants are in full rebuild mode.
And I guess what I'm asking is this. Is it justification for the New York Giants, mainly their ownership? I do understand the notion of you allocate responsibility to subordinates. You've got to let them do their job. The great George Bodenheimer once told me that. You got to let your subordinates do the job that you hired them to do. I understand that notion. The flip side to it is that Pat Shurmur didn't have a winning record. He certainly didn't have a stellar reputation as a head coach coming in and getting the job from the New York Giants, and we know how ultimately, even though the Carolina Panthers were guided to a Super Bowl appearance by Gettleman, there were a lot of things he left to be desired before he departed from Carolina. So considering the questionable history of both of those guys, shouldn't that have been taken into consideration before allowing them to unload a talent like Odell Beckham Jr.?
Well, I mean, ownership was on board with hiring those guys because those guys were going to allow ownership to have some level of influence in terms of developing the plan for 2018. Like, I mean, the decision that you passed on a quarterback at 2 last year and drafted a running back, the only reason that the franchise would do that is because they already thought they had a quarterback in Eli Manning. But in all of this, I think the hierarchy of the Giants, they were wrong in their evaluation in terms of what that team would be able to accomplish in 2018. And missing on that evaluation is what put them in the situation where they were forced to make a hard decision on Odell Beckham Jr. But that's why the Giants are here where they're at right now. And I think that based on the decision to trade Beckham, ownership has got to be on board with what Dave Gettleman and Pat Shurmur want to do. Dave Gettleman and Pat Shurmur didn't give ringing endorsements of Odell Beckham Jr., but they understood that ownership wanted Odell around. They gave him the contract extension. They thought that he would be in line with what they wanted to do in terms of establishing an agenda It just didn't work out that way, and I think that's why they shipped him to Cleveland.
But what evidence do they have that he wasn't in line with what they wanted to do, Chris? Because to me, having antics on the field or doing a sit-down interview with Josina and basically, you know, talking about it, sometimes you're frustrated or whatever and you want to win. Or outside of that, throwing your helmet into a net or engaging in some on-field antics from time to time that didn't really cost him anything. It's not like the guy didn't show up to practice. It's not like he didn't show up on Sundays. It's not like it was his fault that Eli Manning would either underthrow or overthrow passes to him all the damn time. What evidence can they point to in your mind that justifies this feeling of disgust, like this guy is not good for our team? I understand you got to take a Tylenol every now and then because of a headache that he could give you on a particular summer. But the way folks talk about Odell Beckham Jr., you would think the guy went AWOL like Antonio Brown purportedly did at the end of the season, for crying out loud. And that hasn't been the case.
Well, Stephen A., you know as well as I do, when you're getting paid the kind of money that Beckham was getting paid on that contract extension, you're getting paid for more than just your production on the field. Like, that's you have true. To be an extension of the hierarchy in the organization and of ownership, not only in the locker room, not only on the field, but in the community. And I think with a couple of things, it's clear that Odell Beckham Jr. questioned the authority in the Giants organization. And I think that's fair to do, because the fact is they had 50 losses over his tenure as a New York Giant. 50. So, I mean, that speaks for itself in terms of what the Giants hierarchy has been doing in trying to field a competitive team. But they've been wrong in terms of what they could accomplish. And some of the moves that they made last year didn't quite work out. The Nate Solder move is something to be questioned. Signing Patrick Omame, that was a bad decision. You cut him before the end of the season. Like, you're looking at some of the things that have been done in the last calendar year, and I think it's fair to question the Giants' plan. But I think moving forward now, you're out of this stage where you're half pregnant as an organization. Are the Giants going for it? Are they rebuilding? We didn't know. We were in this gray area. I think it's clear now that the Giants are in rebuilding mode. And I think this trade can be judged as a winning trade if and only if Dave Gettleman uses the capital that he got in return to somehow parlay that into the Giants landing their future franchise quarterback.
But before we move forward, Chris Canty, let's stay in the moment where we are in terms of really dissecting rationales and reasons behind why this trade took place. Let's look at it from the perspective of a Saquon Barkley. There is no question that Saquon Barkley is a stud. There is no question that he is a talent worthy of being picked number two overall like he was last year. There is no question that Odell Beckham Jr. and him had a really good relationship. But is it possible that one of the frustrations that Odell Beckham Jr. may have had was in their willingness to pick a Saquon Barkley as opposed to prioritizing changing a quarterback position from Eli Manning to somebody else that could actually throw him the football?
Well, listen, I'm sure that was a part of the frustration, and you saw glimpses of that in that interview that he did with Josina, because Josina asked him a very pointed question. She said, do you believe in Eli Manning as the quarterback of this team moving forward? And Odell Beckham Jr. gave a half-hearted answer. In that type of situation, if you're the face of the franchise, wide receiver getting paid that much money, anything else other than him coming out and saying yes was saying that he wasn't sold on Eli Manning. And I think that's the case. But if you're the New York Football Giants, you knew going into last year's draft that it was going to be a decision on whether or not you were going to take a quarterback or whether you were going to take a running back. You decided to take Saquon Barkley, and you ended up rolling with Eli Manning again. So I think that it's a situation now where you realize one of those stars that you had on offense, either Beckham or Barkley, was going to come at the expense of being able to have a quarterback. That's it. That's what it comes down to.
Chris Canty right here with Stephen A., ESPN Radio, ESPN News. Dissect Eli Manning for me. We watched him last year. Believe it or not, he had a better completion percentage last year than at any point in time in his career. He completed over 66% of his passes last year, and he never had done that throughout his entire career with the New York Giants. But we all know what our eyes are telling us, that he's not very good any longer. You played for this team. He was your quarterback at one time. I know that you know football. Dissect for us what we have been seeing from Eli Manning and whether or not there was any justification whatsoever in Odell Beckham Jr. giving something less than a 100% endorsement of him.
Well, here it is, Stephen A. I mean, Eli Manning has a diminishing skill set, and that's what you would expect for a 38-year-old quarterback, especially when the organization for the better part of this decade hasn't put the right protection around him. That offensive line has been a mess since Super Bowl 46, and they've juggled to try to figure it out, and it still hasn't worked out. And so you had four new starters from the group that started in 2017 to the group that started in 2018, and it still didn't begin to play better until after week eight. And so I look at that and I say Eli Manning is not capable of overcoming the deficiencies that they have on the offensive side of the ball and deficiencies overall on the roster. And when you're paying a quarterback that kind of money and he can't be a force multiplier, then you're going to find yourself in a bad way as a franchise. Dave Gettleman talked about not being in quarterback hell, but that's exactly where he's found himself at right now. And this team is not going to get to a point where they're consistently competitive until they get real about trying to find the next franchise quarterback.
So with that being said, Chris Canty, why is Eli Manning still a quarterback of the New York Giants in your estimation? The answer seems obvious, but I think it's important for somebody that's a former teammate of his that played for the organization to let our listeners know. Why is he still the quarterback for the New York Giants?
Well, it's a couple of things. First of all, I just think there's a level of respect from ownership toward Eli Manning because the guy was an integral part in putting two more trophies in the trophy case.
Right.
So, I mean, he was Super Bowl MVP in 42 and Super Bowl MVP in 46.
And he's class personified. And he's an absolutely nice guy.
In terms of representing himself as an athlete in New York City, I mean, the only person that you would put in terms of doing it at that level would be Derek Jeter. So, I mean, you have to respect what Eli Manning has meant to this organization for the last decade and a half. So I think that's a part of it. Also, the ties that Eli Manning has to ownership because, I mean, Eli Manning is the last link in that Ernie Accorsi, Wellington Mara era of Giants football. So there's a little bit of the human element and emotional attachment in that regard. But I think the biggest reason why Eli Manning is still on this team and accounting for a $23 million cap hit in 2019 where you're cutting payroll everywhere else is because you're going to want Eli Manning to be around to mentor the young quarterback. Again, I go back to saying the only way that this Odell Beckham Jr. trade makes sense is if you use the capital to parlay that into putting yourself in position to get the next franchise quarterback.
But, Chris, can you trust Eli to do that? Because remember a couple of years ago when McAdoo, Mr. Pudgy Pat Riley wannabe with the slick back hair in the shades, he didn't bench Eli Manning. He asked Eli Manning to play a half and let him bring somebody else in the second half. And Eli Manning, at least according to the reports, refused to play. And obviously last year he played all 16 games. So I'm wondering how receptive Eli is going to be in that tutor, that mentor to the whoever the heir apparent is, which we assume will be Dwayne Haskins out of Ohio State, assuming that he lands at number 6 and the Giants get him. I got to look at it from that perspective, Chris Canty, and wonder, can I trust Eli to be that guy?
Well, listen, Eli Manning and his explanation on why he took the approach that he did when he was benched for Geno Smith, he said, listen, if you're going to go with Geno Smith or Davis Webb, go ahead and let them be the starter for the entire week and get the lion's share of the reps because there's only so many reps to go around in a practice. And in order for one of those young kids to have their best chance at being able to go out and execute the game plan on Sunday, you want them to see the majority of the reps in practice. So from that standpoint, Eli's explanation does make sense. But in terms of what he would be willing to do if the Giants were indeed to draft a quarterback at the top of this year's draft, I think you have to look at what Dave Gettleman said at the combine and what he said at the end of the season regarding Eli. He said he had a no-holds-barred conversation with Eli Manning, and then at the combine, he alluded to the Kansas City Chiefs model and what they did with Alex Smith mentoring Pat Mahomes. So I don't think that Dave Gettleman just threw that out there for no good reason. I think that gives you some insight into what he's thinking, but we won't definitively know until we see what they do on draft night.
But is Dave Gettleman capable of having a no-holds-barred conversation with Eli Manning, considering the fact that his authority can easily be usurped by ownership because of their relationship with Eli Manning?
Well, I think ownership is embarrassed about what happened the last couple of years with the Giants, and they realized in doing what they did last year, they made a mistake. So the fact that ownership allowed Dave Gettleman and Pat Shurmur to trade Beckham leads me to believe that ownership is going to give Dave Gettleman and Pat Shurmur the autonomy to be able to do what they need to do. And if they think that the best plan is going ahead with Eli Manning and at some point Eli Manning giving way to the young quarterback at the middle of the end of this year, then I think ownership would be on board with that.
Chris Canty right here with Stephen A. ESPN Radio, ESPN News. Just a couple more questions before I let you get on out of here. The first and third round pick will materialize into what, in your estimation, for this upcoming draft?
Well, I think anything less than in trying to find your franchise quarterback is unacceptable. Like, you have the 6th overall pick, you got the 17th overall pick, and you got a 3rd round pick. I mean, you have to think that you're going to use that capital to try to move up in the draft and put yourself in position to get one of those quarterbacks. Now, if you don't have a conviction on one of the guys this year, then trying to acquire future draft capital. But, I mean, anything less than finding the future franchise quarterback over the next couple of drafts based on what you did last night would be unacceptable, in my opinion.
I'm worried that somebody is going to draft. I don't think that Kyler Murray is going to go past number one because of Kingsbury in Arizona. And I think when you look at, you know, the Raiders at number four, I don't think that the Raiders – I think that the Raiders could ultimately look to nab a quarterback the likes of Dwayne Haskins if at all possible, especially since you just acquired Antonio Brown. I'm of that mindset. Are you worried at all that Haskins isn't going to fall to number six like the Giants are hoping to?
Oh, yeah, I'm absolutely worried about it. I mean, you look at the last several drafts. I mean, you've seen quarterbacks go 1-3 last year. I think quarterbacks went 1-2 in 2016, and quarterbacks went 1-2 in 2015. So if prior draft history tells us anything, I mean, you're likely to have a couple of quarterbacks within that top five. They always get pushed up because we understand that it's a quarterback-driven league. So, I mean, if you're the New York Giants, you have to have some serious concern, especially with the interest being so strong from the Arizona Cardinals on Kyler Murray. Because the minute that one of those quarterbacks comes off the board, you know that there are going to be other teams that are scrambling to move up to put themselves in position. And keep in mind, the San Francisco 49ers, they've given themselves a little bit of flexibility with their draft plan because we all knew they needed an edge rusher. One of the moves that went under the radar last night is that they traded a second-round pick to Kansas City for D. Ford, and they paid him a five-year, $87.5 million contract extension. So, I mean, they have some flexibility to move back if they want to, and you know there are teams behind the Giants that are going to be looking to get up.
Not only that, I'm also looking at I'm looking at the four and fifth picks in the draft, the Raiders, because they're not sold on Derek Carr, right? I'm also looking at the Buccaneers. I know that you've said Jameis Winston's your quarterback. I saw him in L.A. Looks in shape. Looks like he's going to be ready to go. We'll see. But the flip side to it is that clearly they were a better offense with Ryan Fitzpatrick. Don't just – if you doubt me, just ask DeSean Jackson. They were a better offense with Ryan Fitzpatrick, but they made the decision to go with Jameis Winston. That could be fool's gold. They could be looking to draft a quarterback for the future as well. I can't put that past Bruce Arians. So to me, I'm looking at Tampa at five, the Raiders at four as two teams that could potentially ruin the Giants' plans of acquiring Haskins, which means that the Giants would probably use the 17th pick along with the sixth pick to potentially move up or at least give up a third rounder and the number six overall pick to move up to ensure that they draft Haskins. To that, you say what?
Well, I mean, it makes sense, right, Stephen A., because we all know there's going to be competition for the quarterbacks. I mean, it's a quarterback league, and it's a quarterback starved league. There's always a need. Four or five teams inevitably are looking for a quarterback in the NFL draft. And so, yeah, I think it makes sense for the Giants to try to package the sixth overall pick and the 17th overall pick and whatever else it would take to be able to move up to two. I mean, if you look at the draft trade value chart, the second overall pick is worth 2,600 points. The Giants pick at six is worth 1,600. The Cleveland Browns pick that they gave them in the Odell Beckham Jr. trade is worth 950. So you can do the math and say, you know what, the Giants have a realistic possibility if they do want to move up to try to do some business with the number two overall pick. But again, it just becomes a matter of the Giants, Dave Gettleman and Pat Shurmur having a conviction on one of those quarterbacks to move up to do it. We know the Giants as an organization has done it in the past. It's exactly what they did with Eli Manning back in 2004. So we'll see what happens with that. But I got to believe that the organization made this move with trying to figure out who the next franchise quarterback is going to be in mind.
Jabril Peppers going to do anything for the Giants considering the fact that Landon Collins is gone and he's now there at the strong safety, spot?
Yeah, I like Jabril Peppers. Okay. I like him. He's a local kid. I mean, he's going into, you know, his third year. And, yeah, there are some things that are left to be desired. But in terms of a skill set perspective, he's comparable to Landon Collins. Again, not the playmaker that Landon Collins is yet, but the skill sets are comparable. He's a box safety. And, oh, by the way, he brings value as a returner as well.
Plus,
so
he's younger.
I like it. Plus,
he's younger and cheaper.
He's younger and cheaper. Over the next 2 years, he's going to cost you $3.2 million. I mean, it's not the 11.2 that it would have took to franchise Landon Collins.
That's right. Last question. Switching over to Gangrene and the Jets. They've acquired Le'Veon Bell. Your reaction to that?
Well, I think they had to land this plane, right? This entire offseason has been about trying to support their young quarterback in Sam Darnold. They've made some moves to fortify the defense. They brought in Adam Gase as the head coach to work specifically with Sam Darnold. But I think when you look at the makeup of the Jets roster, I mean, it's a team that's going to have to be led by their defense because that's where they have most of their significant investments, both in terms of cap space and in terms of draft capital. But, I mean, being able to add a playmaker that can take pressure off of your young quarterback like Le'Veon Bell, I mean, this is a fantastic get for Mike Maccagnan. And guess what? Le'Veon Bell is going to complement what your team should do really well in 2019, which is play good defense.
Ladies and gentlemen, I usually don't start off my show with any voice but my own, but you make exceptions when greatness is in front of you. And I'm talking about a great, great NFL analyst, the one and only Chris Canty, host 98.7 FM New York City, Humpty and Canty, right here with Stephen A. Chris Canty, appreciate you, brother, as always. Thank you so much, my man.
Thanks for having me on, Steve.
All right, the one and only Chris Canty. And I mean what I say. I ain't lying. I ain't lying to anybody. This is one of the best analysts in America right now in the National Football League. Chris Canty is no joke. Listen to him on 98.7 FM in New York City every weekday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. on 98.7 FM in New York City. Plus, he's on television as well as FS1. But that ain't going to last long because I'm going to get him back here. This is the last thing I do. One of the best analysts in America. Make no mistake about it. Chris Canty right here with Stephen A. ESPN Radio, ESPN News. That was Straight Talk Wireless, nationwide coverage in America's largest and most dependable 4G LTE networks. You are listening live to the Stephen A. Smith Show, ESPN Radio, ESPN News. Whole bunch of NFL stuff to go to. Mark Ingram's about to go to the Baltimore Ravens. Did you hear that news? Did you hear that? That's going on along with a host of other things to talk about in NFL circles. Don't touch that dial. Josina Anderson did an outstanding job reporting on the Giants and Odell Beckham Jr. She'll be on the start off hour number two as well. So make sure you don't touch that dial. Plus, I'm right here. I'm getting ready to get to the calls because I want to hear how everybody feels about Le'Veon Bell in New York, about Odell Beckham Jr. going to Cleveland, about him leaving New York City, about Eli Manning still staying in New York City. The list goes on and on. Don't touch that dial. It's the Stephen A. Smith Show, ESPN Radio. Radio, ESPN News. By the way, do you have freaking heartburn? Like the kind where you have antacid stashed everywhere.